back of the net. In the 20th century, it was the Welsh that were the proud owners of the term WAG. But in this decade, the acronym was stripped of its innocence forever. So what exactly is a WAG?
I got no idea what a fucking WAG is.
A WAG, obviously, is a wife and a girlfriend of a footballer.
Yes, thank you, Bianca. And let's go over to Dictionary Corner and find out exactly where the term WAG originates.
The FA always used to call them the WAGs because it was just for sort of ease on their briefing notes of how they were going to kind of corral these women around to various different places.
But where did they come from all of a sudden?
The rise of WAG culture obviously coincided with a particularly bleak, materialistic, acquisitive, greedy period in British history. I think this decade WAGs have been so prominent because footballers are earning more money. You know, only in the last decade we've seen footballers earning, you know, thousands upon thousands of pounds every week.
Nobody gives him credit, but you have to thank Sven-Göran Eriksson for popularising WAGs. The fact that the wives and girlfriends were allowed to attend the training camps and stay in close proximity to players caused a big furore amongst the sports reporters.
OK, if after all that you're still thinking of becoming a WAG, here's the essential checklist.
You've got to be blonde. Half of that blonde hair's got to be extensions.
Big boobs.
The white teeth. Got to get a fake tan.
Oh look, it's Danielle Lloyd, the waggiest of all wags.
It's very nice.
You like that, do you, Sven?
Beautiful.
I love Danielle Lloyd, she's great. Again, she's committed, she's focused. You know, doctor, lawyer, wag.
Yes, to become a wag is now the canniest of aspirational career moves.
Back in my day, girls wanted to be nurses and primary school teachers and go around the world helping people. And now, all they want to do is have sex with a footballer.
If your daughter came up to you and said, I'm either going to be the assistant manager of Superdrug or I'm going to be David Beckham's girlfriend, what would you say to him?
Next, a teenage ramp. At number 40, got a light, mate. Ah, the good old days when we could have a fag with our pint and the warmth of a local boozer.
Tonight, MPs have voted for a total ban on smoking in public places.
One of the defining moments in modern British history came when the government passed a smoking ban in the mid-noughties. Social habits were to be changed forever, and the nation was divided by this cloudy issue.
I think it's absolutely criminal. I can't believe the way, not just this country, the whole of Europe has just gone, OK, Daddy, we won't smoke.
To be honest with you, I think it's against human rights.
I knew that once significantly more than 50% of the population didn't smoke, a smoking ban in public places was simply a matter of time.
If you can smell it on your clothing, it must have a massive impact on your body.
I think we have enough evidence to show it damages people's health. And because we have that evidence, we should really support that kind of smoking ban.
It's not a sin to smoke. It's not an illegal act to smoke. And I cannot understand this smoking ban.
I rather like the fact that you can go out to a pub or a restaurant and, you know, your clothes don't smell of smoke the next day.
If I had a pound for everyone that said, oh, it's so great, I get home and I don't smell of smoke, you know, I'd be a millionaire. Don't stop me
now. It's a measure, I would argue, of how rational this measure was, that it already seems strange that you were ever allowed to sit in a restaurant and light up a 42-gauge Havana cigar and blow a fat cloud of smoke across a fellow diner's food. I mean, absolutely staggering idea.
We no longer have fat cigars ruining our dinners, and pubs and clubs are no longer smoky dens of iniquity. Smokers are now forced into the street where, despite their complaints, they seem to have a lot more fun.
The thing is that now even if you go to a nightclub, you meet the most interesting people outside because they're smoking.
And you get a little cabal, you get a little club. I have to say, I sometimes go out with the smokers just to be part of the club.
I mean, I'm a married, very happily married man, but it is so easy to pick up a bird now who's a smoker. Because you're outside, you're smoking together, what do? You get stuck into a conversation. It's great.
Well, Wazza seems to be making the best of things, but for Mr. Burns, extreme measures might be the only option.
I can't bear the no-smoking rule, because it makes me want them more, because they're forbidden. I'm going to get 5 holes punched in my neck so I can smoke 6 at once.
Now the T5, an invention that changed our lives forever.
Here's a handy thing to take to a picnic. It's a portable telephone, but as you can see, one with no strings attached except for this little handle here.
Mobile phones, they're great, aren't they? But believe it or not, at the beginning of this decade, they were still cumbersome, ugly, and you couldn't really do an awful lot with them.
Up until about 8 or 9 years ago, mobiles were still really big and chunky, you know, and they had an aerial on them, and sometimes you have to put the aerial up, you know, like you're in the Second World War in the trenches, putting an aerial up. Yeah, I think I can hear someone there.
I had a mobile phone years ago. It was a Nokia. I can't remember what make it was, but it was a Nokia. It was huge. Hello? Walking down the street, thought it was Don Juan de Marcos. Just like, hey, what's happening?
Nowadays, everyone's got a mobile phone. Trouble is, we can't really seem to live without them.
I can't imagine life any longer without a mobile phone.
I almost have mobile anxiety. Like, you're talking to me about mobile, I'm thinking, where's my phone?
On my mobile phone, I've got Facebook, I've got BlackBerry Messenger, I've got my messages, I've got email, I've got everything. So if I was to lose my little contraption, then my life would be, like, over for that day.
Actually, they're not phones. They're the instruments that we run our lives on.
Yes, the modern mobile is a calculator, a diary, a camera, a music player, a storage device, and you can play games on them. And if you're really lucky, it'll be one of those smartphones.
I'm very, very bitter about the iPhone. I want an iPhone. Even my unemployed mate's got an iPhone. I don't. I've still got a... It's over out there, actually. I've still got a phone that I think was made in 99.
I think my iPhone's the best thing I've ever had in my life, and that includes my penis.
Well, I can't really comment on that. But I do know that despite the popularity of the mobile phone, there are still some people out there who can't stand them.
The kind of, like, a torture mobile phones, I wish they'd never been invented. You're having a shit, someone phones you on the mobile phone. You're having sex and the mobile phone goes off. They make you... You've got to look at them.
You can switch them off, you know.
It's a piece of metal and plastic with a few chips inside it, and you control it. It doesn't control you.
Next up, a new noughties law which allows everybody their right to a gay day. In the 20th century, we made many social strides forward, but one key group seemed to have been left behind. Amazingly, it wasn't until 2005 that gay couples were given the legal right to civil partnership.
Literally 20 years ago, I was on the streets of London as part of an AIDS activist group called ACT UP, getting arrested, blocking traffic, to campaign about the rights of people with HIV and AIDS. 20 years on, I was on Tower Bridge with my partner, who's from Brazil, with his 82-year-old Brazilian father, blocking traffic, being photographed for our wedding photographs. Now, if you told me 20 years ago that that photograph would be taken, I'd never have believed you.
Everybody has a right to make a fool of themselves, don't they? Everybody has a right to make a mistake, and everybody has a right to hope. And I think it symbolises hope. It's like cosmetic surgery. It doesn't make things better. You still feel the same, and you still have bad days and bad months and bad weeks, and you hate each other. It's just much more of a palaver to say, fuck off and get out. You've got to do it through lawyers.
Love and marriage.
Since the law changed, there have been more than 27,000 civil partnerships in the UK, including no shortage of celeb couples. Stand-up Sir Elton, Hercules, John.
If our sole aim in life is to be noticed, then it's another opportunity.
It's wonderful that he got married, and I thought his pomp and ceremony was perfectly fitting for who he is. And they're still together, and I hope that they'll always stay together. I think he is actually probably a good example of why gay marriage should happen.
With nearly 1 in 2 heterosexual marriages ending in divorce, why on earth do gay folk want to say I do?
Gay people don't want to get married, they just want the right to get married.
right? Which makes total sense. We're not going to force them to actually get married. We just are giving them the option, which obviously they'll turn down.
Although the majority of heterosexual marriages end in divorce, the vast majority of gay marriages so far don't. Now, maybe things will change when we've caught up with you guys. give us a few generations. Maybe it'll change. Still haven't found